5, 6, 7, 8.
I directed the shows Pippin in Chicago and the films Cabaret and Lenny. But still, people don't know my face. It's been said that the art of choreography is only about 50% conception, and that the real test of your talent is getting 5 or 6 or however number of people in a room who are just a little crazier than you are and who can try to live out that thing in your head. And sometimes, if you're very lucky, you can find someone who dances it better than you ever dreamed it. And for me, that someone was Miss Verdon.
I wanna be a dancing man, girl, while I can.
Girl,
gonna leave my footsteps on the sands of time. If I never leave a dime, never be a millionaire, I don't care. I'll be rich as old King Midas might have been, at least until the tide comes in.
Director and choreographer Bob Fosse died last night of a heart attack as he walked to the opening night revival of one of his musicals. He was 60. Bob Fosse's art, even more than is usually the case with creative people, reflected his life.
To be on the wire is life. The rest is waiting. It's showtime, folks.
It's impossible to portray a man's life without getting to know him pretty well, without getting to know his faults and his virtues and getting to love him for both.
I came from a very large family. I had a lot of brothers. They were all very tall, like 6 foot, and they all were into sports, and I was this little runt. And it was pretty tough around that house to get attention. So since I couldn't play basketball or football or anything very well, I started dancing around, and that's how I got my attention.
When I started studying dancing, I really went because I had a crush on a girl, and she went to dancing school, so I followed her to dancing school, and she quit the next week, and I stayed there and kept studying. But in my neighborhood, it was not wise to walk down the street with tights, I can tell you.
Every Fred Astaire film that came out, I would sit and watch 5, 6 times. In Chicago, I used to go to all the vaudeville houses. I see a lot of wonderful black acts, you know, the Nicholas Brothers, all of those wonderful acts. And then I'd go home and I'd try to do what I saw. Until finally I started doing an act and I really couldn't afford a choreographer to teach me anything, so I started doing my own things.
And he found this boy to tap dance with. And instead of using their own names, they called them the Riff Brothers, because riff is a tap dance expression.
I was making $60 a week, because that was the minimum, $10 a night. And I could go back and tell my friends what a terrific time I had and about all of these racy women around. And how wonderful it was. In retrospect, as I grew older, I realized that I was very, very lonely.
Masa si love.
Bob did study many kinds of dance, but he also played drums because he wanted everything that was rhythmic.
He was convinced all his life that whatever he did, there was always someone who did it better. He once told me that when he developed a dance act with Marianne Niles, his first wife, he used to open the act by telling the audience, "You've heard of the champions? We're the runners-up."
A lucky strike extra. Raymond Scott sets the pace for Flossie and Niles.
Mark Twain's ever young sweethearts, Tom Sawyer and Becky Thatcher, magically come to life.
They were both extremely young, and unfortunately, the marriage didn't last. Bob met Joan McCracken, an extraordinary performer, and they were married.
She was about 12 years older than I was. She never quite told me. My ambition was just to be a nightclub performer, and she said, "Bobby, you got more than that, and the problem is you don't have enough schooling, enough formal education in the theater." So I just took a year off, got myself a bicycle, and went from class to class. I never dreamt I'd be good enough to be like Fred Astaire in a movie. I wanted to be, but I thought, I'll never make that. He was my idol, and I don't know if anyone has ever seen Astaire dance that doesn't fall in love with him. And I went to MGM at 23 years old, made a screen test, and had all those hopes and dreams in my head. And they took one look at me, and they said, "Well, he needs a toupee." Well, of course, my heart broke. And it was at MGM, and it was one of those long streets. It was lunch hour, so it was deserted. And I saw him, you know, his walk is, you have to recognize that walk. And there was just the two of us. And it must have gone on for two blocks. Just, I kept getting closer to him and closer to him and closer. And when he got to him, he just sort of flipped his hand and said, "Hiya, Foss." I thought my heart would jump out of my chest. And Fred Astaire at least knew part of my name. I would imagine he's the strongest influence I've had in my dance career. But there were times when I just out and out tried to imitate him.
Bob often talked about his limitations as a dancer. But if you look at film of Bob dancing, I mean, you keep thinking, what are the limitations? The first movie that Bob choreographed was Kiss Me, Kate. Not the entire movie. Hermes Pant was the choreographer. And Hermes always said, "You just have a way of dancing. So why don't you choreograph your own piece?"
Thank you.
very competitive, mostly with himself. He didn't need siblings. He had his own sibling rivalry built right in. The alley dance. Bob loved it because he could compete with a ballet dancer, and Tommy Rolt was truly fantastic.
Pajama game. Jerry Robbins had seen some things that I had done and said you should do a show, and he sort of sponsored me.
I think Steam Heat was the first dance number on a Broadway stage that was pure Fosse, the way Fosse would do it. He could have been any of the three, because they look like Bob, dance like Bob, and it's exactly the way Bob would have jumped up at a party and danced.
I got it.
Truly, my style came from physical problems. I always had a slight hunch in my shoulders. So as a dancer, I began hunching, and I was losing my hair very early, so I started wearing a lot of hats. And I never had the ballet turnout, so I'm going to do the opposite and turn them in. So the whole style has come out of my defects. I thank God that I wasn't born perfect.
They told me to pour some more oil in the burner. They told me to pour some more oil in the burner. They told me to pour some more oil in the burner.
But that don't do no good.
Coal in the boiler.
No good.
Oil in the burner.
No good. Cold.
No.
Hot.
Yes.
Yes, yes, yes.
Come on, Union. Get hot.
I think the big influences were first Balanchine, because of all the weaving and patterns, And Bob really felt that Jerome Robbins was an absolute genius. But Agnes DeMille and Jack Cole are the ones who changed musical theater from what we had known. Agnes brought ballet into it, and the people were not animated wallpaper. They were characters in the show. And for Jack Cole, he introduced jazz into theater. Bob studied at the theater wing on the GI Bill of Rights. Then he switched to Neighborhood Playhouse, and that was where he first met Sandy Meisner.
I think basically what I was after was to learn what actors are about so that I could deal with them as a director myself. Sandy affected almost everything that I did. I think he had some sort of motto on the wall, as I remember, saying, don't just say something, stand there. And I found out in choreography frequently that less movement, more economical movement, or no movement at all makes a stronger statement than a fierce activity.
Bob was able to combine work with another great love, baseball, in Damn Yankees. First on the stage, then on screen. He knew that dance on film had to be different from on stage. He learned about cutting, camera angles, lenses. He knew all that stuff. The film version also means a lot to me. It was the only time we danced together in a movie. It was very difficult to keep up with Bob when you were trying to dance with him. He's a terrific jumper. Well, he can fly. I can't. And we'd be right in the middle of the take and he'd say, jump. But it was wonderful. I guess they talk about jet streams where you just coast and you don't feel the energy. You wouldn't even know you were tired till you stopped.
For there is an element of doubt as to who's got the pain when they do the mumbo, who's got the pain when they go erp, who needs a pill when they do the mumbo, who needs a pill when they go erp.
Cry at Lassie on television. No, he was, no, not a romantic. Yes, he was a romantic. He didn't like to admit to it. He hated sentimentality, that sloppy, goopy kind. You know, stand there and sing about, I love you, you love me, we'll love one another forever. Because he knew forever is not forever.
He was 11 days older than me and was a constant source of kidding. And he'd say to me, in the first 11 days of my life, before you were born, I had more girls than you'll have in the rest of your life.
My name is Dobie Gillis.
That's Charlie Trask. Give me a happy five.
How are you?
Staying at the dorm?
Yeah.
Got a roommate yet?
No.
I'm with you.
Well, what do you say we go look for some dames, huh?
You wait right here. I'm gonna tell Ted about you.
But you don't know anything about me.
Well, maybe we could take that up later.
You want to quit the show?
Quit the show.
You don't have to do anything for me. But just don't kid yourself that you're doing the show for any other reason except guilt about me.
Guilt? What guilt?
For never going one day when you were faithful to me.
Oh, that guilt.
I'm in love with a man, Plaza O, 4433. It's a perfect relationship. I can't see him, he can't see me.
He gave her kisses and promised a moon.
The late 50s and early 60s were a very productive time for Bob. He became a director, as well as a choreographer and performer.
I feel merely marvelous, wilder than the sea.
I think the most special show, and still one of my favorites, is Redhead. It was a murder mystery musical, and that's where we got married.
What a smack can do. I could fly, I could soar, I could cry, I could roar.
Oh, I believe in you. I believe in you.
The opening night of Little Me in New York, a very hostile and inebriated man got out of his seat and kind of walked up the aisle on his way to the men's room, and he turned to us and he said angrily, "This is the worst goddamn show I've seen since My Fair Lady." About 100 dancers had leapt across the stage. One very attractive but very nervous young lady came out prepared and then did her run, leap, twist, and jump and landed with a great smile on her face. And Bob said again graciously, "Thank you very much." And the girl stood stunned. She walked over quietly, picked up her dance bag, and said to Bob, "No one says thank you to me," and proceeded to pummel Bob with her heavy dance bag. And she hit him so hard, she knocked him completely off the stool, and Phil Friedman and another stagehand pulled her away, screaming and kicking into the wings. And Bob got back on the stool and smoothed back his hair, and he said, "Ladies, no more dance bags on the stage, please."
Our only child, Nicole, was born in 1963. I took a break from performing and went back when she was three.
This was to be my present to her on a return to Broadway. So I tried to get in the show everything that Gwen could do so well.
Let's have a wonderful salute here for a great star.
We'll be right back.
quite a successful Broadway show. And then they asked me to make the movie of it. Fairly comfortable with stage techniques, and now I was thrust into an entirely different way of looking at things. However, the more involved I became with film, the more fascinated I became. Good or bad, stage direction has certain conventions, certain restrictions. In film, however, the only limitations that I've discovered are the limitations in the director's head.
Can I have the playback up a little bit, please?
Right. The wonderful thing about a camera is that you can come in on a hand, you can come in to a face, or some movement that you don't get in that proscenium. I'm gonna get up. I would guess the big spender number was probably the most difficult number to translate to screen time. It played well on stage, I think, because I lined the girls up along the rail, staged a lot of movement and business for them, and then allowed the audience to decide for themselves where they wanted to look, at which particular girl, at which particular moment. Now, the camera had to choose for them.
Is everybody ready just for me to sing one?
Yeah.
The minute you walk in the joint, far up.
I could see you were a man of distinction, a real big spender, good looking, so refined. Say, wouldn't you like to know what's going on in my mind?
So let me get right
to the point. I don't pop my cork for every guy I see. Big, big spender! Spend a little time with me.
How's about a few laughs?
I can show you a good time.
Do you wanna have fun, fun, fun?
How's about a few
fun laughs? Fun, laughs, fun, laughs,
I can show you
laughs, laughs, fun, laughs, good time.
Fun, laughs.
Fun laughs, good time.
What do you say to us?
How's about a
laugh?
I could give you some.
Are you ready for some
fun?
How would you like a?
Let me show you a
good time. Hey, big spender.
And before they saw the movie, when the word was just around California, I had hundreds of offers to make movies. Hundreds. Four. But after it opened, I mean, it was pretty cold. I mean, no one really wanted me for a long time.
Like anyone else, I'm afraid of failure. Although I don't think that's the major thing. And afraid that the ideas that I have, I don't have the talent to execute.
If people, interviewers, would say, you know, what is your motive? What drives you? He would say fear, and everyone would laugh, but Bob was telling the truth.
I threw up twice a day when I was a performer. Now I throw up three times a day, so it's about equal.
2 weeks now. We've been on triple time. The brass is eating my ass out.
Bargaining.
You shot 82 days on a 65-day schedule. On a four-month editing schedule, you've gone 7 months. We're already 2,000,002 over the original budget. Joey, God made the entire world in 6 days. He didn't go on overtime once.
A truly talented artist is almost by definition excessive. Only when you have enough to throw away do you have enough. Everything about him was excessive. Neither his passions, nor pleasures, nor pains were packaged to suit the shrinking times. And since all of him was equally excessive all of the time, he was, by some paradox of emotional geometry, in a constant state of excessive equilibrium.
Money makes the world go round, the world go round, the world go round. Money makes the go round of that we both are sure on being poor.
Money, 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 money.
And then Cabaret came along, and they offered it to like 5, 6, 7, 8 other directors who turned it down for one reason or another. I know Billy Wilder turned it down. I know Gene Kelly turned it down. And when they said, you know, would you like to do it? I said, oh, yeah, absolutely.
Cabaret was set in 1930s Berlin. Bob cut back and forth between the political turmoil in the streets and the escapist fantasy of the cabaret to reveal the connection between them. Like much of Bob's work, Cabaret used show business to comment on society. Liza is so quick. If you say cry, boom, she can cry. And Bob said, if you feel like crying, I want you to fight like an animal not to cry. He wanted her absolute gut emotion, and he got it.
It's only a cabaret, old chum, and I love a cabaret.
Cabaret was the most acclaimed work Bob ever did.
And the winner is Bob Fosse for Cabaret.
The Oscar launched Bob's unique achievement, his triple crown year.
Being characteristically a pessimist and cynic, this and some of the other nice things that have happened to me in the last couple of days may turn me into some sort of hopeful optimist and ruin my whole life.
Here's a free minute from Pippin, Broadway's musical comedy sensation, directed by Bob Fosse.
Thank you.
Pippin was not doing very well, and Stuart Oster, who produced the show, had this idea to put the first television commercial on. I did shoot that commercial and edited it, and business started booming, and the show ran 6.5 years.
You can see the other 119 minutes of Pippin live.
The winner is Bob Fosse.
The winner is Bob Fosse.
Bob Fosse. Stand it again.
That's what Bob could do to you. He could put you through the ringer and make you test yourself to the limit, because that's what he was always doing to himself. He was one of those people that you had to gear yourself up to be with, because he always wanted to be at your best. If you were going to have lunch with him, you had to go out and have lunch someplace else first, just to break in your conversation.
I think everybody, that every actor, every dancer that I've ever worked with, wants to be asked to work to their maximum. I don't think an actor's ever done this with me before. He started to cry. He started to cry and he said, Bob, I don't think there's any more in me. I don't think I have anything left. I think I've given everything I've got. And I said, well, I don't think so. So he dug down and he came up and he was absolutely brilliant the next time.
Your Honor, I so want your respect. I know you're a good person, and I know that this legal system is the best in the world, but you can't seem to hear me.
Mr. Bruce, sit down.
When I'm talking about tits and ass, I'm not up there just to shock the audience by repeating those words, tits and ass, ass and tits and tits and ass. The point I'm trying to make is that we all live in a very hypocritical
Mr. Bruce,
society.
You leave me no alternative but to find you in contempt of this court.
Lenny Bruce would push people's buttons. Bob thought that was very important. At least they had to think and react.
Then sentence me. I have no money left. Might I be sentenced now? I can't afford to be on trial. The police took away my cabaret card. I can't work anymore. Please, sentence me.
No, I will not sentence you today. I order you, when you appear before me again, to appear with suitable counsel.
And I'm further ordering psychiatric evaluation by the psychiatric clinic. December 16th. Bail continued.
You're trying to stop the information.
Bailiff, will you please remove this
man
from the courtroom?
You see, that's where it's at, and you can't stop the information, because the information keeps the country strong. You need a deviant. Don't shut him up. You need that madman to stand up, tell you when you're blowing it. And the harder you come down on the deviant, the more you need him. Please, don't take away my words.
Bob came home one time, and he said to Nicole, I've been offered a movie, Little Prince. And Nicole was crazy about that book. So she said, oh, you've got to do it. And Bob always said, the next thing I knew, I was in Africa.
What are you?
I'm a snake.
I'm enchanted.
If you would like to leave that inhuman race and take up residence out yonder in space, when you are ready to go traveling on, sit right down upon a snake in the grass. One sting is quite enough to make you happy and free. One sting, and you'll discover how relaxed you can be posthumously. And while you're wandering through the heavenly blue, if you should see the Lord come strolling in view, go up and say you bring him best wishes from his fallen old chum, a snake in the grass. A snake in the grass. A snake in the grass.
Mm-hmm.
It's almost painless.
I remember he told me he'd rather I swallowed flaming swords in a circus than be a dancer. And I said, no, you don't understand. I love it. I really want to dance. And he said, okay, then go to class. And I said, yeah, I'm going tomorrow. And he said, no, go now.
Get out your white suit and tuck shoes and tail.
Scoop.
Let go
scoop,
backward
wrinkle.
When forward fail.
Strut. I know.
Moon stars got to start a long dead.
Look familiar, Joe.
Now frame beside your bed. Don't throw an ass away. You might need it some rain day. Dreams can come true again.
Gave me a lot. I mean, we have a wonderful child together. We had many theatrical successes and a lot of fun. I think working with her is probably one of the most exciting experiences I've ever had in the theater. It was only when the work stopped that the trouble began.
We separated in 71, but separate is not the right word. We just didn't live in the same house.
But, you know, I worked with Gwen after we were split up, and it was a very successful relationship.
Come on, babe, why don't we paint the town? And all that jazz, I'm going
to... Chicago was theater and politics. Bob's response to Watergate, with the corruption of his hometown in the 1920s, reflected in a series of vaudeville acts. He brought sensuality on stage, not just being sexy, but real eroticism.
Yes. I had open heart surgery about 5 years ago. I was world class. Smoker. I was into 5 and 6 packs a day. I got hooked on Seconal for a while, which is very dangerous. I was taking Seconal and Dexedrine at the same time, and I was hallucinating. I don't recommend it at all. I mean, I don't think it helped my work. I don't think it helped anything.
Most of Bob's best friends were writers. The closest were Patty Chayefsky and Herb Gardner.
Somewhere in the early 70s, the three of us, can you believe this, were asked to join together to do Dino De Laurentiis' remake of King Kong. Although we'd worked on each other's stuff for years, some animal instinct had always kept us from working with each other. Anyway, we decided to take the offer seriously, and years later we admitted to each other that each one thought the other two needed the money. It also, after all those years, lent a certain dignity to our hanging out. Bobby immediately assumed the role of director and assigned us our jobs. Patty, he says, you will handle the dignified, philosophical, thematic part of the script, that is, the boredom. Herb, you will do your usual semi-comic lyrical bullshit. You'll do the whimsy. And then I'll shine it up so maybe somebody will come and see it. I'll do the flash. It was decided then, this is many years ago, that the corporation we formed to do the movie would be named Boredom, Whimsy, and Flash.
Herb was doing a film called Thieves, and he could not find somebody to play a bum, a real derelict.
Hey, you! Let me introduce ourselves to you. I'm Mr. Day, Mr. Knight, with the team.
I do.
What you got here is junkie folk. No alcohol, no...
So Bob said, I'll do it.
We're straight ahead junkie folk. We come to Bob $35.
So many people expect a person after open heart surgery that it changes their perspective. I don't think it changed Bob. If anything, he became more driven, wanted to be better.
Bob Fosse's Dancin'. Dancin', Bob Fosse's pulsating, electrifying musical sensation.
Bob did have this idea of doing a series of dance numbers. All the ideas that he'd had over the years, which would not fit in a show.
Bob Fosse's Dancin'.
My own life's probably a little too dull. So that's been greatly fictionalized and characters combined and incidences added and the chronology of it's off. But a lot of it's based on my life.
And this tremendous need that we all seem to have to accomplish something and not getting the really most out of our lives. And I don't know. I mean, show business is very important in my life. I mean, and I'm eternally grateful for all it's given me. But there is an underlying hate that I have for him, saying it's really hurt my life and I think I could have gotten more.
Bob's last movie was an outcry against exploitation, especially of women. It was a true story.
When the editor of Playboy told me I had won Playmate of the Year,
I have this feeling about Dorothy. She's gonna be a big star. Together, we could be somebody.
I thought it was the best picture I'd made. Certainly, technically, it was the best.
Playboy is a very special magazine, Dorothy.
They're gonna give me $10,000 for having my picture taken.
Photography and everything I thought was just absolutely exceptional. I thought what the picture was saying was very important.
They're all nice to you. Everybody is wonderful. Mr. Hefner is wonderful.
So when you put your best work forward and then it seems to be rejected by the public.
Go out and get yourself a job, get something going, and try to make her proud of you.
He's got the personality of a pimp.
Do you think Hefner liked me?
I never got such split reviews in my life as people loving it and really hating it, really being angry about it.
You've grown, and he stayed the same.
We have some things we should talk about.
About a divorce, is that what you mean?
Please come back to me.
I want it to be over.
Shut up!
And all my friends, you know, who try to console me say, well, that must be something. If they get that angry, you got to them somehow.
I started when I was 13. I've been a professional since I was 13. And that's all I know. And I'm happiest when I'm rehearsing. I'm happiest in places like this.
Bob's last Broadway musical, Big Deal, revisited a favorite Fosse theme. The little guy who tries to get ahead and just can't, but never stops plugging. He said it in the Chicago of his youth, and he used actual songs from that era.
I have distorted the meaning of those songs a great deal to suit my own sense of humor. It was fun not having to argue with composers all the time. And also, I think a lot of composers don't want to work with me anymore. But I wanted something that I'd never done before, which is basically a very hard, driving, rhythmic number. It is just so percussive. It is really like there are a bunch of drummers up there. They're required to hit very hard accents like a drummer. The dancers all say this is the weirdest dance we've ever done in our lives.
Big Deal was misunderstood by the critics, but also misunderstood by Fosse. What he did was compose a folk opera in operatic time using the found materials of American standards. I think when he died, he was still growing and still struggling to reformulate himself. In American culture, there's a great tradition of artists coming out of the vernacular, out of the street, like Walt Whitman or the novelist Theodore Dreiser, who was uneducated and worked as a newspaper drudge almost from his early teenage, or like the juggler, W.C. Fields.
Anyway, dancing has been my whole life, and it's been good and it's bad, mostly good. This year has been incredible for me, considering I had one of the biggest flops on Broadway. It's hard for me to understand because I was given something called the Astaire Award and something called the George Abbott Award and a Tony Award and now this. And before I die, I just want one more thing, and that is for the New York Times to say one nice thing about me.
In Bob's terms, I don't think he considered himself a success because he was never quite satisfied with what he had done.
I like that sense that it could very easily fail. It's a kind of, gives me an impetus that I need to work harder, and I always like fighting the odds.
I believe it was Oscar Wilde who once said of a project, "The anxiety is unbearable. I hope it lasts forever."
I wanna be a dancing man, girl, while I can. Girl, gonna leave my footsteps on the sands of time. If I never leave a dime, never be a millionaire, I don't care. I'll be rich as old King Midas might have been, at least until the tide comes in. Let other men build mighty nations and buildings to the sky. I'll leave a new creation to show that I was dancing by. I wanna be free as any bird can.